Okay, so hello everyone. My name is Mateusz, and I'm for DeepMind. Today's talk is a little bit perhaps educational, and it's about one but important aspect of creating deep learning tools. And this is about modeling invariances about using deep learning tools. However, first I will start from this simple question. So let's imagine that we have the scene of different objects, and then we have also a question like, what is the color of the cube to the left of the big metallic sphere? Right now I will pause for half a minute, and then I will let you to try to answer this question about this image. OK, I'm not going to give an answer. You can keep this answer privately. However, what I would like to point out is that to answer such question, we have to do a lot of complex things. Like, we have to see the scene. We have to analyze the scene. We have to understand what the objects are in the scene. We have to also see the question. We have to analyze the question. We have to take different words from this question and also associate with different parts of the image or with different objects in the image. Then we have to specially understand what it means to be to the left, to the right, behind, etc. And then at the end, we have to also put do some reasoning process in order to derive answer about this question about this particular image. So this example is an instance of visual question answering problem, and that will be the running example that that I will use in this talk to discuss invariances that are injected in different deep learning architectures, and also to show different components that you can use to build a visual question answering system that can essentially solve this problem. Okay, however, first, let's go back in time to the year 2011. And at this time, I, as a computer vision researcher and other researchers, we were interested in so-called image classification problem. In the image classification, we have image, and this image, those images are relatively low resolution. This one, this particular one, has 32 by 32. And then there's one question that is associated to all the images. And this question is, what is in the content of this image? The answer is a category. So in this data set, in CipherTan, there are 10 categories, such as cat, dog, truck, etc. And that the whole task is to map this image into one of those 10 categories. Around that time, there was also this big philosophical discussion about building recognition architectures. And on one side, we have one philosophy that is arguing for handcrafted architectures, which basically means that each component of this visual system we should handcraft. On the other hand, on this side, there are people who are arguing for learning-based approaches. So instead of creating such recognition architecture by designing different particular components, perhaps we should design a learning algorithm and then let the algorithm, the architecture, to learn the weights, suitable weights based on the data. The tipping point happened in 2012-2013 with the AlexNet results on the image classification data set. And since that time, we have started following the latter philosophy, so basically learning-based approaches. And here I'm showing three breakthroughs in the image classification that were very important and are still very influential in this field. And first is namely large data sets of images. The second is about deep learning architecture. And the third one is about massive computational power, like, for instance, GPUs or TPUs. For the sake of this talk, I will focus on the deep learning architectures. And in particular on the convolutional neural network. So convolutional neural network is a particularly successful architecture for the image classification that is roughly inspired by biological visual system. It consists of a hierarchy, of building hierarchy of different representation at different scale. And it's decomposed into simple cells and complex cells. Simple cells are searching for patterns in the image, and complex cells are adding some kind of robustness, some kind of invariance to the features. The crucial component of the convolutional neural network is a convolutional kernel. Right? And what this really means. So let's say that we have this image, and then we have the convolutional kernel that is over there, right? And convolutional kernel is essentially looking for a pattern. And let's say that the pattern, for the sake of simplicity, let's say that this is the pattern that this kernel is looking for. And it's looking for by scanning different patches of this image, right? Once the pattern is found, the corresponding artificial neural cell is activated. So it gives one, otherwise it gives zero. So in this case, the corresponding neural cell that activates is this one, and all other cells are basically zero. Then at the end, we can do a histogram or summarization of those patterns, and this gives the description of the representation of the image, statistical representation of the image. So, currently, what I said, this approach is not very applicable. And the reason is that if you're searching for exactly the exact match between this pattern and the patch, then the problem is that if you rotate a little bit the object, like this car, for instance, then the pattern is different. And since the pattern is different, then you don't have match anymore, obviously. So this is not a very useful approach so far. So instead, what we should do is to think about maybe some abstraction of the patterns, like for instance in this case. And instead of having this binary 0-1 match, perhaps we should start thinking about some similarity measure, like for instance correlation. So how this patch is similar or correlated with the pattern that the convolutional neural network is or convolutional kernel is looking for. The key property here is actually the fact that convolutional kernel is searching for this pattern over the whole image, which basically means that we can expect some features, like for instance a car wheel here or maybe over there, right? It's the same with other objects, like for instance faces. They can be here or it can be there. So there's no really one particular position where the when these patterns or a feature can fire in the image. So the question is how to derive or how to build such patterns. And here's this problem that for many years, researchers in computer vision, they were thinking about. And the problem is that if this pattern is too specific, like for instance, it's exactly this guy here, then as I mentioned, if we rotate the object, or if we disturb the object a little bit, even if this is the same object, even if this is the same person, even if this is the same car, then we lose the exact match, right? So if you have something too specific, then it might fire only in very specific instances. In contrast, if the pattern is too abstract, then it matches equally well with this car wheel and this part of the door, which is also obviously not very useful. So how to do this? Like in history, we were just asking this question. We get inspirations from biological research. But currently, we are just giving this for the convolutional kernel to learn. So we specify some weights. And then during the training process, the weights become suitable, hopefully suitable for the problem. So hopefully they are not too specific, and hopefully they are also not too abstract. However, of course, we shouldn't only care about one pattern, one match, but we should think about a collection of different patterns, right? So you can think, in high level, you can think about this as evidence, like collecting evidence that some object belongs to some category. So for instance, if there are like different feature maps, and each feature map is searching for different patterns, like for instance, car wheel pattern, or lighting pattern, or window pattern, or turn pattern. And then we have, if there are like a lot of firings, if there are a lot of occurrences of such pattern in the image, then there's more and more evidence that the whole object is a car, right? So in the end, we can basically have a convolutional kernel that is looking for different patterns in the image. Then we can collect or do some histogram based on the findings of particular layers of the kernel, of the convolutional kernel. And then the more such firings, then it's more clear that it's basically the object of interest is basically a car. So if there are any questions, maybe, or? Let's go, okay. So, focusing on the convolutional kernel, we have the following important property here, that the conceptually convolutional kernel can be thought as this window scanning process. Right? So the convolutional kernel is the green thing here, and the whole image is this grid. And as you can see, the kernel is looking for a pattern locally, right? So there's this local neighborhood that the kernel is searching for the patterns. But it's searching for these patterns by scanning the whole image from top to bottom in some way. Of course, this is a conceptual simplification, because in practice, you can use parallelization, and then you can have all those matching at the same time. But conceptually, you can think of that basically there's some searching process, right, over the window. And there's this sliding window that is searching for a pattern. And when we are thinking about this, then there's a crucial difference between convolutional kernel and the fully connected layer, So here we have fully connected layer. On the left side, we have convolutional kernel. And what are the differences? So first, in the convolutional kernel, we have much fewer parameters. There are only 9 parameters that corresponds to this green box here. In the fully connected layer, in contrast, we have all the connections between the artificial neuron and all the pixels in the image. And this causes a lot of parameters, right? So again, like in the convolutional kernel, we have 9 parameters. In the fully connected layer, we have as many parameters as the input resolution. So it can easily go to 60,000 or even more. And this causes a problem, like learning problem. We have a lot of parameters. This doesn't scale that well, because we have this hidden assumption that all the images have the same resolution, etc. And this is not a problem with the convolutional kernel. However, what I want to point out is that in building convolutional neural networks, we have this particular property that we are interested in, and this property holds for the images, not necessarily holds for all data, but definitely it holds for the images. And it's a correlation that nearby points in the image are highly correlated. And also the special invariance, which is basically that the feature or the pattern that of the interest can be at the bottom or it can be at the top, etc. So we basically need to have this sliding window approach. As a result, convolutional neural networks are the status quo for the image representation. Of course, here, for the sake of this presentation, I have simplified a lot of things. So in order to build a very successful image recognition approach, we need residual connection, we need we need some certain depth, we need also some optimization tricks, etc. However, still, I would say that one of the main components of the success of such architectures is basically this convolutional kernel. So it's this way that we are thinking about the data, about the images, and what kind of invariances, what kind of properties we want to inject into the architecture in order to make the training possible. Inductive bias is a technical term that we are using for describing such design decisions, such design choices. Like, for instance, if you are using convolutional kernel or if you are using fully connected layer, etc. And roughly speaking, it can be divided into and in fully connected, for instance, we can think that we have a artificial neuron that is looking for the all pixels in the image. So we have like all-to-all relation. And at the same time, we are not assuming anything special about the data. There's no invariances, there's no spatial structure, etc. In contrast, in convolutional neural networks, the relations are defined locally, so it's defined over this small neighborhood. And at the same time, we care about some kind of invariances. In this case, it's about a spatial translation invariance. Okay, so we have, let's say that we have an image representation, which is output of the convolutional neural network. However, to solve this problem, this visual question answering problem, we not only need to have good image representation, but we also need some representation of the language, some representation of the question. So now the question is how to build such representation. And to follow up the previous speaker, we can use recurrent neural networks to build such a representation. However, by building this, we can still think about some properties of the data, some properties of the language that we want to encode in the architecture in order to make this architecture successful. So let's think about the language for a minute, right? So the language can be seen as a sequence, potentially infinite sequence of tokens of the words, and then it has to be invariant in time as well, right? So for instance, if I'm asking the same question about the same scene today or yesterday or in different times, then the answer should be the same. So there should be invariance under time shift, or equivariance of the representation across the time domain. And of course, such problems, such architectures can be used for different language problems, like for instance, in machine translation, where we have two recurrent neural networks. One recurrent neural network is encoding a sentence from one language, and another recurrent neural network is decoding a sequence, a sentence in another language. Having those properties in our mind, namely the time invariance and also that the sequence can be potentially infinite, we can describe recurrent neural network using this representation that I called rolled representation of recurrent neural network. And then we can see that we have an input that is frozen in time, so it's an input from arbitrary time step. And then we have some processing unit, and this processing unit is a neural network that is taking this input and is producing the output. And now we have the same trick as we have done with the convolutional neural networks, right? In convolutional neural networks, we have this local neighborhood, and then we have a special invariance, and therefore we have a weight sharing across the special domain. And here we have weight sharing across the time domain. And because of this, the sequence can be potentially infinite. So if I have a question of length 10, then I can basically 10 times put this processing unit. But if I want to scale to a test time, I want to scale to, let's say, questions of the length 20, then I can just replicate or copy-paste the same processing unit forward, right? And I can do this because the weights are the same. The weights are shared across the time. However, there's also another property of the language, and this property is basically the time, the history. So if we just have a processing unit that takes the input and producing the output, then there's this hidden assumption that processing unit is doing some processing steps independently, right? So we have like, at this stage, we have like independent neural networks that are doing something with the language word. However, of course, this is not the case. The language has the historical dependency, and this historical dependency can be put back by this arrow, the second arrow. So in total, the processing unit, or recurrent neural network, is taking the input, and it's also taking the, as an input, output of the recurrent neural network from the previous step. Right? So this is basically a recurrent neural network. And again, we can develop this recurrent neural network from a very simple observation that language is a potentially infinite sequence that is shifted in time, that is invariant under the time shifts. So to summarize those inductive biases. So first we have fully connected, which is about the all-to-all relation. And there's no really special structure. There are no invariances that are incorporated in this fully connected layer. We also have convolutional neural networks that are about convolutional kernels, where the relations are defined locally, right? So basically, it's about this weight sharing across the spatial structure. And those are kernels that are very small and are looking at the local neighborhood. Recurrent neural network, recurrent neural network, we can also talk about relations. Those relations are across time. And we can also talk about invariances. And this is like time translation invariance by in the recurrent neural network. OK, so this problem, visual question answering, is still about, it's not only about language, it's not only about images, it's also about connecting those two things together. And how we can do this? One of the very interesting and very powerful property of deep learning is that it can take arbitrary input, potentially arbitrary input, and it can produce some vector representation of this input, right? And once we have vector, we can use mathematical tools like, for instance, linear algebra in order to combine those vectors together or process those vectors in some particular way. So the easiest way of combining the language or the question with the images is the following. We take the image. We process the image using convolutional neural network. We take the question. We process the question using recurrent neural network. So LSTM is one important recurrent neural network that is also very successful in real-world applications. And then what we can do is that we can concatenate those two representations, those two vectors together, right? So if we concatenate those two vectors, we get another vector, and then we can start producing the answers based on this vector representation. And I do believe that this is one of the most important, actually, properties of the deep learning, that everything, that from the deep learning point of view, everything is a vector, or everything is a tensor. And therefore, we have the same currency that can be used through the whole learning process, and through the whole, let's call it, reasoning process. And here there's also this recursive formulation that is basically emphasizes what I said, that we have those question words, then we have LSTM, and then we have a CNN representation or vector representation of the image. We plug them together by concatenation, and then we keep going to produce the answer. And those answers are produced by using this formula, which is maximum posteriori. But essentially, it's like you can think that it's a multimodal representation, common representation of the image and the question. And then we are looking for the most plausible answer giving this vector, giving this multimodal representation. However, when we again think about visual question answering, then visual question answering is also about relations. Right? So we have something like cube is left of the big metallic sphere. It can also be behind, can be right of, etc. But clearly, there's this relational component in the problem. So again, we should perhaps we should start thinking about these principles or these properties of the data, of the things, of the invariances that we want to encode. First, let's recall the convolutional neural network. So again, we can scan using convolutional kernel, we can scan the image. As the output, the convolutional kernel is giving vectors, and those vectors are listed here, and they can be seen as a vector representation of different parts of the image, or basically the objects. From the question side, we are using a recurrent neural network that I already also mentioned. And then we plug them together with the convolutional, with the vectors that are obtained by convolutional neural networks. And here in this special case, I'm concatenating those two vectors together, but of course we can use other operations from linear algebra. It doesn't have to be concatenation. But how concatenation works fine. So again, we have different vectors, convolutional neural network vectors. They're associated to different parts of the image or to different objects in the scene. We broadcast LSTM, the vector produced by recurrent neural network, by the LSTM. And this is basically broadcasted, tiled, and plugged together in order to build this multimodal representation. However, so far, there are no relations. So the question is, what are the relations? What are the properties of such relations? And we can start thinking about this high-level abstract thing. Since many relations are binary relations, like A is left of B, B is left of C, etc., then perhaps we should consider all the pairs of such objects. Right? So for instance, we can take the object at the top, which is red, and arbitrary another object that is blue. Or the red object and arbitrary another object that is green. So this gives such, this results in n square objects, n square pairs of the objects, sorry, because we are taking arbitrary objects. And in terms of the invariances, we have those, let's say, relational invariances, right? So what does it mean? It means that basically, if the object A is left of B, then this object B can be in almost arbitrary position in the image. So for this reason, we cannot really apply convolutional neural networks directly, because convolutional neural networks are only looking at the local neighborhood. So if I use convolutional neural network, then convolutional neural network was pairing those two things together, pairing those two things together, etc. But here, we want to pair arbitrary things together. We probably also don't want to use LSTM because it's difficult to imagine that there's some ordering here, time here. In some sense, this ordering is arbitrary. And so by thinking in this way, we can come up with the following representation. We take arbitrary vectors, we put them here, then we use one-by-one convolutional neural networks. One-by-one convolutional neural networks are equivalent to multilayer perceptron or linear layer that is put on those on each pair. So it's put on top of every such pair of the objects. And when you think about this, this can be seen as a function that is doing some kind of comparison about those objects, right? So we take, let's say, this object and this object. We consider the pair of the objects, and then we put MLP or one-by-one convolutional neural network on this pair. And this convolutional neural network is essentially doing comparison, compares the relation between those two objects. Using this operation, we get a list of different vectors that we can see here at the top. And here there's, again, some invariance property that we can think of. And this property is that we took those n square objects, pairs of the objects, in arbitrary way, which means that there's no really ordering, which means that we need to find some operation that is permutation invariant. And permutation invariant means that we can take those objects, then we can swap those objects, and then still we can get the same representation, the same final representation of the input. And this can be mathematically done by summation operation, so it's a very simple operation, but at the same time, this operation is a permutation invariant operation, and it's suitable for this kind of problems, right? So again, we have like CNN, image representation, it produces the vector-based representation of the image. We have LSTM, which is a recurrent neural network that produces a vector-based representation of the question. We take arbitrary pairs of such objects here, and then we process by using MLP or by equivalently one-by-one convolutional neural network in order to build this comparison. And then at the end, we use a summation operation as a permutation invariant operation to build a final representation. So this can be also successfully applied to other problems, the same ideas. And another architecture that is also using the similar principles is called transformer. The transformer was initially applied to language, to machine translation problem. However, it can also be applied to other domains like visual question answering, or it can also be applied to action recognition, where we have a video of some people doing something, like for instance, answering to the phone. And then there are also objects, and then we can also have this pairwise relationship between those objects using transformer. Okay, so let's summarize this part. So we have like different inductive biases for different kind of problems. For arbitrary problems, we have a fully connected layer that is that assumes nothing about invariances. There's nothing about spatial structure. For the images, we have convolutional neural networks that is assuming something about the images, about the data. And this is about the relationship that is defined locally. And also about, and it's also, there's also some assumption about the invariances, and in this case, it's a spatial translation invariance. In recurrent neural networks, we are assuming another type of invariance, which is time translation invariance. We're also assuming that there's this relationship across the time. Relation networks is about relational inductive biases that I have just talked about. And this is basically about that relations can be at arbitrary positions, so we shouldn't look for local similarity between two objects, but we should look more globally across all the objects in the image. All these things can also be generalized a bit further, and then we can develop basically the same learning algorithm and the same architecture that given input can produce a satisfying output like answer, like translation to another language, etc. So for instance, we can use a graph to describe such invariances or to describe how the things are related to each other, so to describe this relationship. And in this case, in the visual question answering, again, we have like nodes of this graph. And each node of this graph corresponds to the object that I was talking about. And then we have also pairwise relationships between two different objects. and this is represented basically by the edges. Right? So if we build such graph that is telling something, that is imposing some structure on the input data, and then we have those nodes, then we can run some algorithm or some architecture to learn from such graphs. And this is basically GraphNet. It's a learning algorithm, and also this is architecture that can work efficiently with this kind of problems where we have a graph structure. And of course, in some instances, we really do have a graph. Like, for instance, we might have some dynamic systems. And in this dynamic system, we might actually have like different nodes. And those different nodes might be related to each other, for instance, by some forces or something like that. In the language, we also can have a tree kind of structure, which is quite natural representation of the language. And in visual question and saying, in this relational module that I mentioned, we can have a fully connected graph. At the same time, if we don't know much about the structure, so if we cannot say that what is the right graph that is describing the best, the input data, then often we can just assume that this is like fully connected graph, and in many cases, it's working pretty well. So GraphNet can be divided into three components. So there's a global component, and this global component is telling something globally about the data. So for instance, in image visual question, I'm saying it can be a it can be a question. There is VI that are different nodes, and there is also the edges, and those edges are talking about the relationship, like what node is, how the node is related to another node. And those are also attributes that are basically the features associated with the U, with the VI, and also with the edges. The next thing is graph updates that I'm showing here. And this basically is telling the following. So in order to update a node XI, we need to take the previous state of the node XI. We need to take the neighborhood of this node. So for instance, if this is the node XI, this is defined by the neighborhood of the node XI. Then we apply G, and G is the same function. It can be neural network, for instance. Again, this is with weight sharing, so it's very similar to the relational module, right? So we take, we'll take all the pairs that are related to the XI node by the neighborhood definition. And then we use summation, which is a permutation invariant operation. And this gives a graph update, and then we can also update this next time so to get more information. And this essentially can also be seen as a message passing algorithm. And this is this works, this is simplification, of course, of this algorithm, but roughly speaking, it works in the following way. So let's say that we have this green node at the bottom, and then we have a red node. We want to update the red node based on this formula. To update the red node, we take the previous state of the red node. We also take all the neighbors of the red node, which is this green node. And then we do the update based on this. In the second step, we are doing something similar, right? So we are updating the red node, which is over there, based on the previous, based on the state of the red node from the previous iteration, based on the neighborhood, which is which are those two green nodes. And there's also this yellow node. And I'm showing this yellow node because I want to emphasize that the red node right now has not only information about the green nodes, but it also has information about the yellow node, right? And this information is passed from the previous iteration, from this iteration, right? So in one pass, we have like this one message passing. So we have like this node is passing the information to its local neighborhood, but in the second time, this neighborhood is passing its own state or its own information to the red dot, and now the red node is informed about this node, and it's also informed about this node. So it has more global information. In three iterations, the top root which is the red node, has all the global information from all the nodes, from the directly from the green nodes, and also indirectly through yellow nodes. And this is basically essentially the essence of the GraphNet that is open, publicly open, so you can download the GraphNet. And GraphNet is, of course, a little bit more. It's also about the age updates, about the node updates, and also about the global updates. And those are some important details about this that you can either check in the code or you can check in the papers. However, for the sake of this talk, I'm not going to touch them. And instead, I go to this final slide, which again summarizes all those inductive biases. So at the beginning, we had a fully connected layer. And this is about all the all-to-all relationship. We also we do not assume any kind of invariances. There's no special structure. All other approaches, they have some special structure. It's adding some special structure to the neural network, to the architecture. Convolutional neural networks are about these convolutional kernels that are special translation invariant, and it's also about the local neighborhood. It's also about weight sharing across the spatial dimension. Recurrent neural networks are in some sense similar, but this invariance is across the time, and relations are also defined across time. Relation network is about those relational inductive biases and about this relational invariance, while graph networks is about actually arbitrary invariance. So we can encode invariance of our wish. The trick is, the point is, however, that this has to be given as a graph. So if you have input data, and then if you have a good understanding of what kind of invariances you want to encode, then you just encode them using graph. And next week, you can use GraphNet in order to do training and reasoning on this graph. And this is essentially the so here I'm essentially finishing this talk, which is about images, language, graphs, and thinking in terms of the invariances, thinking in terms of inductive biases that are important while you are developing or we are developing different deep learning architectures. So that's all.
Thank you very much.